Mark Antony, hero or villain? Mark Antony was a pivotal figure in the late Roman Republic, but who was he? A brilliant leader of men, was he a misunderstood hero or a terrible villain? History has been harsh on the memory of Mark Antony. But flawed though he was also brilliantly talented. These words, spoken through Mark Antony in honor of the assassinated Julius Caesar, were imagined by William Shakespeare. Yet, their sentiment could so easily apply to Antony himself. Historical figures are nuanced, complex, and contradictory. Just as they are capable of great acts, so too can they prove to be fallible and tragic. Both Antony and Cleopatra, his Egyptian lover, are now infamous. First and foremost, Antony was a soldier. As a young man, he went to Greece to train in oratory and soldiering. Serving the proconsul Gabinius in 57 BCE, he fought with distinction in Syria. As commander of the cavalry, he earned kudos for his fearless military exploits. With a chiseled jaw and a strong athletic body, Mark Antony was every part the swashbuckling young hero. By 55 BCE, Gabinius and Antony were in Egypt, trying to re-establish the claim of Ptolemy 12 elites. This was Antony's first foray into Egypt, a land that would shape his destiny. With ties to the popular politician, Clodius, and familial connections on his mother's side, Mark Antony next secured a post on the staff of Julius Caesar. Serving in 54 BCE, in Caesar's Gallic campaigns, Mark Antony showed exceptional promise. Caesar so valued the young man that Antony's political career was sponsored, and he became a quaestor in 52 BCE. However, by 52 BCE, he was back with Caesar in Gaul at the famous Battle of Alesia. Mark Antony's next role was as Caesar's proxy in Rome, resisting the damage done by Caesar's optimate enemies, who wanted to strip him of his command and prosecute him. By 49 BCE, Antony, now tribune of the plebs, was vigorous in his interventions in the Senate. Agent to Caesar though he was also growing as a political figure in his own right. His eventual expulsion from Rome gave Caesar his critical reason for unleashing a civil war. As Caesar seized Italy and scattered Republican forces under Pompey, Mark Antony played a key role. While Caesar pursued a war in Spain, Antony administered Italy, his colleague Marcus Aemilius Lepidus acting as governor of Rome. Well liked by the soldiers, one of Antony's earliest failures would manifest in his role as civil governor of Italy. Complaints of a lax and high-handed administration followed, and the foundations of Mark Antony the villain started to be laid. A recurrent theme throughout his career, the notion that Antony cared nothing for republican sensibilities, made for easy propaganda for his enemies. The accusation that Antony was arrogant, reckless, and lazy with men's legal rights mattered, especially among Roman citizens, who had known only the protection of the Republic. Antony was no greater a robber of men's rights than any Caesar or Octavian. Yet, unlike them, Antony failed to understand the importance of appearance. However, Antony was also brilliant. A hero on the battlefield, Caesar granted him command of his left wing at the battle at Pharsalus in 48 BCE, where Pompey was defeated. A true soldier, he was beloved by his men, eating, drinking, and joking easily with the troops. These were not just gestures, Mark Antony being also an immensely able commander that frequently went into battle. Yet, the flaws in Mark Antony's political leadership came again in 47 BCE. As master of the horse, he presided over violent political fighting in the Forum of Rome. Brutally suppressing the political legislation of his rival Dolabella, Romans were shocked, and the trouble compelled Julius Caesar to return from Egypt. The specter of Antony the villain was taking shape. As Republicans saw it, who, but Mark Antony, the junior despot, would have the gall to offer Caesar, the arch-despot, the crown of Rome? Romans detested kings and tyrants, and it was this that would cost Julius Caesar his very life. That Antony was spared murder rested only on the fact that even Caesar's assassins could not decide if Antony was a hero or a villain. With Caesar dead, Mark Antony was the sole consul of 44 BCE. Manipulating events to deliver a funeral oration to the mob in Rome, Mark Antony masterfully turned the volatile crowd as they gazed upon the bloody carcass of Caesar. This was Mark Antony the orator, and his intervention fundamentally changed Roman history, unleashing events that would force the murderers of Caesar to flee the city. In sole possession of Caesar's legal will, Mark Antony was now de facto leader of the Caesarians. He was almost perfectly placed to take on Caesar's historical legacy. Almost, and yet, not quite. The coming to life of Caesar's adopted heir, the teenager Octavian, was catastrophic for Mark Antony. Underestimating Octavian's abilities, Antony controlled Caesar's wealth. Octavian borrowed money to pay for Caesar's inheritance, giving money to citizens and veterans, and defeated the experienced general.